left to do before our time together comes to an end, and I am excited to dive in. In just a few moments, James Ryan, president of the University of Virginia, will join us alongside College Board CEO David Coleman. As many of you know, David joined the College Board in 2012 with a big vision for expanding access to college for all students. He immediately took action, redesigning the SAT in 2014 and expanding access to free world-class test practice. David is also overseeing the most comprehensive changes to the Advanced Placement Program since its inception 60 years ago, and enhancing tools like CSS Profile, Student Search Service, and Landscape to better serve our higher education members. David continues to prioritize and invest in programs designed to propel students of all backgrounds to college. Whether he is on stage in the limelight, as he will be momentarily, or back in the College Board's office working with his team and planning for the future of our work, one thing about David that is always true and clear is that he prioritizes our students. He worries about our students, serving our students, and finding ways to improve access to opportunity for all of our students. When I speak on behalf, I think I speak on behalf of my fellow trustees and David when I say that without the insight and the input of the committed members in this room, we would not have been able to deliver on David's vision and to have accomplished all that we have. So, it brings me great pleasure to welcome College Board CEO David Coleman.
Welcome, everyone. Welcome to Forum 2019. It's been a tumultuous year in our sector, but some things remain the same. I'm still kind of astonished at the depth and reckless feel of love I have for my husband, who I've been with now for about 11 years. And we still have twins. They are now almost 5 years old. They'll be five about Thanksgiving, and they still don't obey or listen to me, and they still don't miss me when I'm gone particularly, or respond when I come home. So nothing really in that way has changed. But I'm lucky to be among you. It's nice to see everyone, our past trustees, our current trustees, our members at all levels, my colleagues, all of you. Welcome, and let's enjoy this last part of our time together. And I have a great feeling from you that whatever the complexity of the roads we'll travel and the currents around us, if we treat each other as peers and colleagues and work together, we might actually do very well and do some good. But there is a question facing us that needs to be addressed. What does grace and change have to do with the two codes that we put the, like what does yesterday's plenary about the Constitution and technology have to do with grace and change? And so is it, for example, that technology is change and the Constitution is grace? I'm not sure, especially these days. So I was thinking there's actually a deeper connection. You know, sometimes someone like Stephanie can give in a bravura performance, but everyone will really remember one sentence for the rest of their lives. For those of you who are here, you'll remember that as a child advocate, she succeeded in her journey only to wind up arm deep in, you said it, I didn't. And the man that is about to speak with me also has a strangely intimate relationship with chickens, So that's how this all ties together. Jim Ryan practiced his Harvard commencement address at the education school that became viral by talking to his chickens that he raises. He describes them as a very receptive and respectful audience. I hope you won't disappoint him. He said of his chickens, perhaps wondering about a comparison with his children, but you'd have to ask him that. He said, chickens need so little, but give so much. But let's work a little harder about what do we mean by grace. Change is perhaps fairly simple. It's something different than it was before, but what is grace? Of course, it probably begins the serious examination of grace with Paul's letter to the Romans, in which he discusses the concept that we are not made right with God by our own works, but can only be forgiven and accepted through grace, not of our own making, but a gift freely given, which inspires Augustine to develop his own theories about grace. But then there is grace's modern reception, what it's come to mean to us. Sometimes just a deft action, one my body has never known, but some might dance gracefully, for example. And it means, I think, a kind of gratitude, a kind of acknowledgement of the forces outside of our control that nonetheless are so mighty in our lives. And in this way, Jim Ryan, the president of UVA, has also made seminal contributions. He wrote a book about two high schools in Richmond. He called it 5 Miles Away, A World Apart. And in this book, he describes how the accident of which high school you are in, and of course, all the other accidents of life, congregate to create such different worlds so close by. Never has a book been more prescient about the terrifying place we find our country in, where even close by, there are not neighbors and not mutual participation in success. Grace seems to be something about paying attention, something about the abandonment of the self, something about getting out of the way. And Jim has been described in a phrase I really like and wish were more true about myself. He is described as almost infinitely patient with people, but impatient in his urgency to make a difference. And grace may be, at its most profound, a certain level of self-doubt. He is famous, again, for this viral commencement speech, and it's about asking questions. And most people, forgive me, in my experience, ask questions sometimes to prove to you how smart you are, they are, rather than truly to inquire into what you're thinking about. And his first two questions that he recommends for us to all consider in our lives are, wait, what? That is, to force yourself as a listener to pause and not project on the person speaking what you think they said or what you think they might be thinking, but to pause to really pay attention. And his next most beautiful question is, I wonder. It's nice to see someone as successful as Jim who believes in wonder, who believes in self-criticism, who worries about his own limits at the same time he seeks to make things change. That is, to me, grace and change. And it's hard, though, these concepts. So I thought I would do, I would try to share with you a very strange thing, which is what grace sounds like. And I think grace sounds like the speech Jim Ryan gave 2 weeks after he was named the president of the University of Virginia, reflecting on Charlottesville. And I'm going to read you a little bit of what he said, because I haven't seen better on this subject. He said, I wasn't here last year. I watched it in horror from afar and in real time online. But that's different from being here. And I would be the first to acknowledge that what happened was experienced differently by many in the community. It was different for those who were close. It was different for people of color. It was different for those of Jewish faith. It was different for those who were young and shocked, and for those who were older and less surprised. Perhaps feeling, in the words of civil rights heroine Fannie Lou Hamer, sick and tired of being sick and tired. I was not personally attacked for a host of reasons, distance, race, and religion among them. So I offer these thoughts with deep humility and in the spirit of an ally. I cannot truly know the pain of others, but I can recognize it and stand with them in sorrow and in support. And that is why I am here today. Indeed, that is a big part of why I agreed 2 weeks after the march to become the next president of the University of Virginia. Despite its flaws, which are not unique to this place, I love this university, and I love Charlottesville, having lived there for 15 years and having raised our kids here with my wife, Katie. I felt compelled, and still do, to stand as an ally with those who were attacked, with those who still suffer, and with all of you who long for a better and more just future. That's what grace sounds like. Let's hear more about change in your agenda. President Ryan, welcome among us. Please come in.
Lovely. Thank you very much.
So, in your first celebrity turn, you gave a speech about questions.
I did.
Tell us, why are questions so important, and what questions are important?
So first of all, thanks for having me, and thanks for that really lovely introduction. So every year, when I was dean of the Harvard Graduate School of Education, I had to give a graduation speech. And what I did was, every year, talk about something I'd been thinking about a really long time. So I don't know if you know this, but one of the topics 1 year was grace. This is it's an issue and topic I've thought a lot about. But I've been obsessed with questions since I was a kid and was an incredibly annoying kid to my family. But as I got older, some of this was from going to law school, I started to realize the power of a good question. You know, when I think about, and this is true across a number of contexts. So if you think about students, if you can help students formulate good questions, you help them learn how to learn. And in today's world, that's maybe one of the most valuable things you could teach students. If teachers are good at asking questions, and I was a law professor for 15 years, and so spent a lot of time thinking about the right questions to ask, that's how you stimulate students. That's how you stimulate their curiosity. And then if you think about what it is to be a good friend, a big part of it is asking the right questions. And in order to do that, you have to be listening closely. You know, when people say, so-and-so is a good listener, what they're really saying is that they ask good questions. Because the only way you can ask good questions is to listen hard. And it's a way, as a result, to make connections. I talk about this in the speech, but when I was a kid at our school, the janitor of our school had a key ring and all the keys to all the doors. And I thought, this was the most powerful person in the school because he could go into any room he wanted. I think of questions like keys on that key ring. They open up doors that you wouldn't otherwise be able to enter. And every time you enter into a new room, you learn something new.
Given the power of questioning for teaching, for learning, to being a friend, maybe even a lover, living with someone, being with different kinds of people, why is it hard? It would seem such a simple instruction.
Well, I think it's hard for two reasons, actually. Three. One is people often aren't very good listeners. So they don't ask such good questions because they weren't paying close attention. The second is that formulating a good question, a really good question, requires an awful lot of knowledge. So there are historically famous quotes from scientists like Jonas Salk, who would say, the moment of discovery in science is the discovery of the question. And what that means is that you have to have mastered a huge body of knowledge to know what the next question is. And so it's actually really, really difficult. The other reason is that I think sometimes people don't spend enough time thinking about how to ask a question. And sometimes it makes all the difference in the world. So some questions, like you say, can come across as aggressive. Someone's just trying to prove how smart they are. But if you think about, you know, just take a simple example. You can't quite believe why someone did something. You could say, what the heck were you thinking about? Or you could say, I'm curious why you did that. You're gonna get two very different responses depending on how you ask.
Yeah, my dad was a psychoanalyst. This is troubling territory. He would always ask me why I did things, and I was just, punish me, Dad. Don't ask me why.
my dad would say, you had better be a lawyer because I can't imagine you doing anything else given how much you ask questions.
Yeah. No, I can imagine. He, by the way, was the first in his family to go to college. Jim is a first-generation student. You said you've thought about grace. I spoke a little bit about grace at the beginning. I wonder what you think it's about and what you thought I got right and what you wonder further about.
So I think you got a lot right. I mean, I think that grace is an incredibly versatile concept and versatile word. You know, you can say grace, you can give grace, you can be gracious, you can be graceful. I think that it is a combination of humility, gratitude, and kindness.
You know, speaking of graceful, the one virtue I have no identity with, I thought I should mention I wear these shoes not to be cool, the sneakers, but because I had back surgery and it's much easier on my back if anyone's worried that I'm not holding my office. In your book, 5 Miles Away, A World Apart, you wrote about two high schools in Richmond. And I just thought, you know, you talked about that aside from football games, these kids, so close, would barely know each other.
Yeah.
And, you know, it doesn't take a genius to see. I mean, our politics seems almost determined now by how small your town is. It's, you know, rural votes one way, urban, suburban another. Did you see the glimmers of this when you wrote? Did you see the kind of divisions beginning? Was that what drew you to it? What do you think's at stake in these differences, and how do we think about them?
So when I wrote, it was about, I was interested in the way that law structures educational opportunity. So when I was a law professor, I wrote about topics like school desegregation and school finance. And this book was supposed to bring that to life. And I thought, I would like to write about a school that's in a central city district and one in a suburban district, but close together. So one was Thomas Jefferson in Richmond, and the other was Freeman in Henrico. And I just wanted to show just how different the experiences were of the students who went to those two schools and how little they knew about one another. And I was mostly focused on the educational aspect of it and not on the broader societal aspects of it. But, you know, if you want to separate adults, a good way is to have them go to separate schools. And they lived in two remarkably different worlds. And I spent a lot of time talking to students, which was the most interesting part of the research for the book. And they would be able to predict the way that they would be described by the other students. And then they would say, but we're not like that. Hmm. And then sure enough, the other students would say, oh, I think they're all like X. So they knew what the perceptions were, but had no idea what to do about it. You see the ramifications. If you want to have an integrated society, you should have integrated schools. If you want to have a segregated society, you should have segregated schools. I mean, we shouldn't be surprised.
Yeah, I couldn't agree with you more. You know, I've been dealing with problems, opportunities, issues of my own child rearing. I just had to send the kids to kindergarten. I grew up in Greenwich Village in New York at a time, you know, the golden era of integration of the public schools. And I was lucky enough, Manhattan was different then, and I actually went to integrated schools for elementary and intermediate. And I kind of sadly, having made no progress, I live three blocks from where I grew up. And when I was faced with the same public schools that I went to, they're totally transformed in their racial distribution. And I just couldn't bear it. And so I actually found a public charter school because due to the lottery system, it was the one integrated school within striking distance. Fascinating. Right.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, if you think about the challenge of segregated schools, you know, it stems from the fact that we have segregated neighborhoods.
Exactly.
So, you know, you don't have much choices. You can either allow for some form of school choice, which is really controversial in some quarters, or you can work on residential integration, which is always going to be slow. Or you can wait for demographic changes, which are happening. I mean, the country's becoming more diverse, and attitudes about diversity are far more positive than they've ever been among the younger generation. I mean, it remains to be seen whether people act consistent with their expressed attitudes. But
you know, it's interesting about Forum. I hope that one thing that we'll do with increasing liveliness is we have leaders here from those different high schools right here today. We have school counselors that work in very different circumstances.
Yeah.
And they're all here together. And independent school counselors work in different circumstances. And deans of admission that work in different kinds of colleges that live in different neighborhoods and serve different kinds of students, from community colleges and others to regional publics.
Right.
And I wish that we could find ways to broker conversation and mutual understanding.
Yeah. Well, you know, what I've always wondered about, well, not always, but since the, I can't say I was wondering about this when I was seven, but.
God, I can really only imagine what you're like.
If you think,
trying to like deal, I can only imagine your father's predicament, really.
If you think about what technology affords you the ability to do in terms of connections, and you hear the stories about a classroom in Missouri being connected to a classroom in China. Yeah. Well, why not connect a classroom in the suburbs of Richmond to a classroom in the city of Richmond? You know, I mean, there are just some ways that you could do to just open up a dialogue that don't require you to actually, you know, change the attendance boundaries of schools, which is really difficult to do, or wait around for residential segregation. I think that there are ways, in other words, you think about students working on projects together. Yeah. There are ways to bring students together even if they're in different schools.
You know, it's super interesting because one thing that's hard about linking up kids from different schools is often the curriculum or what they're studying
exactly,
is so divergent.
Right.
But we have an opportunity in advanced placement.
Right, exactly.
And in the last five AP courses, the new ones we've launched recently, there's always a required project.
Right, so you guys should do this.
Yeah, maybe we should do it.
Right,
what do you think? Should we do this?
All right, yeah.
Let's do this. More work for the AP team. That's what they're thinking now. You're welcome. A year ago, you delivered an acclaimed speech that I quoted from extensively. I just wondered what it's like in the time since then, and how you find your heart and how you find your mind about the events that transpired now.
Right. So it's now 2 years plus since the white supremacist rally in Charlottesville, and also through the grounds of UVA. And you know, it still reverberates, no doubt about it. I mean, it was a traumatic experience. I mean, I didn't appreciate that. I mean, if you think about it, it makes total sense. But for the students I talked to, I mean, that's the first thing they said.
Yeah.
I mean, this is an incredibly traumatic experience. Put aside the larger significance of it.
Yeah.
That still lingers to a certain extent, although there's also a great deal of resiliency. I would say the most important change is that there is an openness in Charlottesville and at UVA to have, in some respects, long overdue conversations.
Hmm.
Long overdue conversations, in particular, about the relationship between the University of Virginia and Charlottesville, especially around issues of race and income. and conversations about whether UVA has been a good neighbor to Charlottesville. And that was one of the reasons I decided to come, because I thought that might happen. You know, oftentimes from tragedy arises opportunity. And that's exactly what's happened. And so we have, at the university, put together a community working group that has faculty and staff from UVA and community leaders. And in the first year I was president, we asked them, just come up with an agenda. What are the top issues facing the region that we might be able to work together on? And don't try to solve them, because we're gonna have to bring some expertise from the community and from the university. And they identified jobs and wages, affordable housing, access to education, access to healthcare. And we've been responding ever since. And I think that there's an energy to that that stems in part to what happened in August of 2017.
Fascinating. And King, of course, Dr. King, was so obsessed with the power of that kind of violence,
right,
to provoke what he described as the deeper spiritual reaction.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, at a fundamental level, you realize you have in common with people who you might have thought you had some differences, a complete and utter rejection of what that represents. And so you start from that point of commonality and you build from it. And that's what's fueled by far the most productive conversations. That's not who we are, that's not who we want to be. And if you start there, then you start to think, well, who do we want to be?
So that's a very gilded picture, Mr. President, of the conversation that happens at your university, because what the press reports, not about UVA, but about college campuses, is that people are kind of screaming at each other, that there are not enough conservative voices, that there are free speech issues, that students are intolerant. I wonder, A, if you agree with that portrait of what happens in higher education at a place like your school or others, and also what you think the real free speech issues are that emerges out of this, particularly given your background in law.
Yeah, so I think that's an exaggerated picture of college campuses, honestly. I mean, you know, it's a story if man bites dog, not if dog bites man. So, you know, the most outrageous example.
You could probably have weaved a chicken into that if you want to just right.
The most outrageous examples are going to get the most attention. I mean, I'm obviously speaking about the campus, or as we say at UVA, the grounds I know best. But I would say that the conversations are almost uniformly civil. There are a diversity of viewpoints, and students aren't afraid to have conversations. And in fact, students organize themselves to have conversations around difficult topics. I think the two free speech issues that are tricky. One is a concern about giving offense. I think that, and some of this is admirable, right? I mean, none of us, I think, or very few of us go out of our way to try to cause offense. And if you're worried about causing offense, you might stifle your own speech. And I see some of that. I see some of that on college campuses. The other part of it is the language that is used to talk about objections to speakers or objections to speech. And obviously, you have to balance out, anytime you're talking about, say, inviting a speaker, you have to balance out the right to free speech with protecting physical safety. And what happened in Charlottesville is a perfect example of that, right? That is a real issue. It's not a made-up issue. But the idea that some speech or some speakers causes psychological harm rather than just offense, right, which is the old-fashioned way of talking about it, but no, this actually causes me psychological harm, either because it causes some sort of trauma or it reminds me of something. That's a, for First of all, that's not made up, but that's a really slippery slope to go down if you start thinking about restricting speech based on a psychological harm that it can cause. And I think that's on the horizon, and in some places not even on the horizon.
Yeah, it's really deep waters, I think.
I think,
especially as we see certain people using abusive speech in ways that are surprising. You know, you describe kindly a world where few of us, I hope, deliberately want to offend one another. And then there seems in our political climate shockingly deliberate attempts to do so. And so it's a strange world we're living in.
Yeah.
And strange for all of us, I think, to try to figure it out.
Yeah.
You know, one thing the College Board's doing on this with Stephanie's leadership is, and Trevor's leadership in advanced placement, is with the National Constitution Center, we've developed a 2-week free module on free speech for all advanced placement students so they can discuss these issues, the five freedoms enshrined in the First Amendment, in the environment of a high school classroom before they get to college.
Right.
I think it's actually a lot of weight to put on young people to catapult them in a new environment. They're trying to understand themselves with new liberties and freedoms and conversational space when they haven't maybe worked on that in high school a bit more deeply.
I agree.
So that's something we're trying to do, is to think about readiness for college as a broader thing that might include free speech familiarity.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a terrific idea. I mean, you talk about the things that we load on to students when they begin. You know, I really dislike the idea that you hear in some quarters that students these days, for some reason, are snowflakes, which I just think is bogus.
Yeah.
And you think about what they are confronting when they begin college. And one of the most significant changes is that for most of them, it is by far the most diverse environment they've ever been in, and more diverse than where they grew up. And
as
suddenly,
per what you said earlier about integration.
Absolutely, and suddenly they're living with people from all over the country, from every background imaginable, and we're saying, talk freely and get along. You know, I mean, I would like to see a group of 1,000 adults do that for a summer and see how it goes. It's not easy.
Yeah, no, really.
It's incredibly important, and in some respects, one of the most important aspects of a residential college, but it is not easy.
And I just want to say something about that, if you don't mind. I am so grateful to those of you who work in higher education to acknowledge this miracle work you do. You're one of the only places in American society left that are integrated in this way.
Right.
And I think when we talk about the value of higher education, its special role in our country, it's hard work. It's much easier to separate out than to do this. And I just honor all of you that do it, all of you that try to lead integrated environments wherever you are and bring different people together. I just think it's amazing.
I couldn't agree more and would echo everything you said.
Yeah. I just thought, in a 2007 address, I liked this phrase. And you might imagine I think sometimes about how much risk to take, and I tend to be a little energetic in my leadership style. You said, happiness is risk's reward, boredom is fear's. Interesting phrase. So some people think college presidents are figureheads who were once powerful people that now accomplish nothing, leading an institution the faculty runs. So I thought, with a smirk and a smile, we should discuss your agenda beyond fundraising to how do you actually hope that you can bring the University of Virginia forward, and how do you balance, just to begin, tradition and innovation? How do you, in your role, both husband this storied place, this remarkable place you've been granted, and think about change?
So I think the way to approach it is to think about what is the essence of the place you're leading, make sure you retain that, but also update it. So one of the core aspects of the University of Virginia is a dedication to service. So the university was founded to prepare students to be citizen leaders to help a new democracy. Obviously, those who were eligible to be students was as narrow as those who were eligible to be citizen leaders, namely white males. But the core of that idea, to serve, has maintained a through line for 200 years. So when we think about, okay, what is our agenda going to be, we thought, well, what kind of place do we want to be? How do we describe what we're trying to be keeping service at the core. And what we came up with was this idea of being a university that's not just great, but also good. A university that strives for excellence, but also tries to be excellent for the purpose of serving. And use that to guide what we do. And once you do that, it's amazing what you can look at and think, oh, well, if we want to be both great and good, we will change this and do something else. Mm-hmm. And so you talk about taking risks. You know, I think it's worth taking risks if you think there's a decent chance that it will improve the student experience, if it will push the bounds of discovery, or if it will make the institution better. Yeah. So I'll give you a quick example for each. So right now, our students, we house students on grounds for 1 year. I think that's a huge missed opportunity because our admissions office, led by Dean Greg Roberts,
is very good and is among us here.
Who does a remarkable job of pulling together a diverse group of students. They only have the opportunity to live together for 1 year, and then they disperse into apartments, often times with friends who they came to the university with. And so if we are trying to prepare our students to be citizen leaders in the 21st century, which is a much more diverse and globally connected place, why don't we give them more of an opportunity to actually live together? So one of the things we're planning to do is to provide enough housing and then require first and second year students to live on grounds. That's not universally popular. I've had a number of conversations with current students. So this will obviously take several years.
Yeah.
So I have had a number of conversations with current students who say, I really think that this is a bad idea. And I listen and I'll say, okay, you're right. I'm not going to make you live on grounds for your second year. So the second, with respect to the idea of discovery, so we took a chance and opened a school of data science. So, you know, the idea of being great and good. So you should, to be great, you need to be pushing the boundaries of discovery. And I think data science is one of the most important new fields to open up. It's not only important in terms of providing students opportunities for employment, but data are obviously everywhere, and how we deal with them matters an awful lot. And then in terms of an institution, this is the last thing I'll say, and this stems back to the working group that we put together. You know, I believe that if you're going to be a great and good institution, you can't just teach your students about the right values that organizations should have. You should live those values. And one of the things that we decided to do early on was to pay our employees a living wage, which had been an issue at UVA for a long time. You know, that's a bit of a risk. It's not universally popular. It costs money, but we believe it would make the institution better.
Yeah. You know, by the way, we agree with you so much on data science. We've gone very long on it. In the new SAT, there's data analysis in the reading and writing section, and evidence-based reading and writing, and the math section throughout, when it really was underdeveloped earlier.
Yeah.
And we've even looked at AP courses like biology to think about how data science pervades biology and modern biology. So it's a very exciting time for us. And if anyone's interested, I did a podcast on Freakonomics recently with the really cool Freakonomics folks about the future of math and data science. So we have a very aligned. But one way we're different is that I've never made a mistake. And so I thought that, you know, maybe you could tell me what it's like to take a risk that goes poorly, given I would not have any reason to understand such a thing. So maybe like a risk that returned more than you hope, and a risk that went worse than you expected, or I in no way prepared him for this question. Yeah.
So the difficulty is
the one that went well.
Picking the right example.
Yeah.
So a risk that went better than I thought.
Yeah.
When I was dean of the Ed School at Harvard, we created this seed fund, and it was dean funding research projects. And the hope was that the researchers would then be able to attract outside funding to continue the research or the programming. And we hope that with the investment, we would get a pretty large return. I had no idea the return that we would get, in large part because I made the mistake of funding a conference instead of research and got a lot of grief for it.
Yeah.
And then that conference about early childhood education attracted the trustees of a foundation interested in early childhood education that then resulted in a $35 million gift to fund early childhood programming and education.
So that was a mistake. Say we were wrong? Or
not? You know, I'm still waiting. But a risk that I took that, I mean, I've taken a number of risks that have not worked out.
One What's that like?
you're so lucky.
Yeah. Just ask the audience.
Yeah, I know.
They're laughing out of sympathy with you.
Right, I know.
Because they know how different it is for most people.
Yeah, no, it actually must be tough to be perfect.
Yeah, it's hard. It hurts my skin sometimes, but go on. Yeah.
So we started a conversation around fulfilling the promise of diversity.
Yeah.
And I thought that this would be greeted with great enthusiasm, yeah, and acclaim. And the problem was that, and this was on me, we hadn't thought it out enough. And so we just launched this. I don't know if you've ever experienced something like this. We launched.
I walked into that on purpose, folks. I don't want you to think. Go on.
We launched this without thinking it through.
Yeah.
And we received what you might call a lot of really helpful feedback.
Did you have to change course? What might that be like?
We did, and we're better for it.
Yeah. I think that question of how to have, of course, I jest because we've been through turns that have made us better with your help to say it. I also think all of us are trying to figure out how to have the diversity and inclusion conversation in a truly respectful, productive, and serious way.
Yeah.
And we're just launching it at the College Board now, so you might share with us,
right,
what you've learned at some point. I do, though, want to try to get you more into some more trouble on stage.
Okay.
I'm worried you've been very poised so far.
Okay.
It's worrying me. So let me throw out some ideas, a quick round of bad ideas or good ideas.
All right.
And so one of them that's circling, particularly with the pressure on the middle class,
yeah,
to pay for college these days, is there such a thing, for example, as an excellent 3-year degree?
Yeah.
And, you know, is there a possibility, I want to be clear, what I'm imagining here is not a narrowly professional degree necessarily or a certificate, but rather deciding that maybe 15 courses in philosophy don't make you a philosopher, maybe, you know, fewer, or maybe there's a less specialized broad degree. You may know that Hutchins at the University of Chicago once imagined a 2-year general,
right,
degree,
right,
but we're now real stuck on 4 for certain kinds of colleges. What do you think?
Oh, so I was thinking about just the timing rather than the credits.
Hmm.
And the reason why I said you could have a great 3-year degree is that it already exists. So at least at UVA, students can graduate in 3 years. Some of that's thanks to,
yeah,
the AP.
Yeah, yeah.
And so students come in,
yeah,
with a number of credits. You know, my only concern would be that college is a time not just of intellectual growth, but social and emotional growth. And that takes time. And so you might be able to speed up the time it takes to earn credits, or you might think we could shave off 1 or 2,
yeah,
courses and not lose too much. But I think you may lose a fair bit in terms of the overall growth of students. And the other thing that would make me slightly nervous about it is that you don't want to create a 2-tier system, right, where those who can't afford 4 years feel pressure to get through a 3-year. And so if you were to do it, I think what you'd want to do is create an option where the finances, to the extent you can control them, wouldn't be an issue. But even so, you're never really going to be able to control differing opportunity costs for students.
Yes, exactly. It's a very deep question. I think we're all going to, as the costs of higher education are where they are and the middle class is where it is, there's going to be a lot of good questions to be asked about
yeah,
the structure of higher
so
education.
Yeah, I think so too. And I know I'm a fan of providing options.
Yeah, yeah, no, I know that of you. And so to put some pressure on us, some of you in the audience may know that I've wondered aloud whether the pressure on students is too much. You worry about their growth and development in college, and the College Board has an outsized role in their growth and development in high school.
Yeah.
And we've worried that the role of that advanced placement, while this beautiful idea of students challenging themselves and doing college level work in the high school and really growing and developing passions, can morph into a terrible arms race of merely accumulating more AP courses, that the advice to take as many rigorous courses as possible becomes this, like, they take you seriously, they take as many as possible. And that could be a great decision for additional rigor if they love those courses,
right.
but in a sense not to get into college. So I think you know that I've wondered aloud, could it be that colleges might look at no more than 5 or 6 AP courses for the purpose of admission, allowing students, of course, to take more, but try to pull it out of this admissions race and madness I see in our adolescent culture, at least in some parts of our society.
Right. So I think the last part is important, and I'll get to that in a second. So I do think that there is this perceived need to take an inordinate number of AP courses that is driven less by interest and more by a sense that this is what is required. And you know, I think that what colleges and universities need to understand at a broad level, and I know Greg Roberts understands this incredibly well, what you ask of applicants affects their behavior in high school. And so what you ask for in an application, what you say you're looking for with respect to students is really important, because it sends a signal that then students and their families act upon. And I'm really amazed, honestly, when I talk to students about the number of AP courses that they've taken. I mean, routinely hear 10, 11, 12, or 13. So I do think that that is part of an overall sense of anxiety bordering on frenzy around college admissions. But that's talking about one segment of the population. So, you know, that's this, not to overgeneralize, but, you know, that's largely middle-income, upper-income
exactly.
families. At the same time, you have lower-income first-generation families who don't have as much exposure to AP tests, don't have as much exposure to guidance counselors, and there's not a frenzy there. What the problem there is that they're either really talented students are either not applying to college or not applying to the very best college that they could get into. And to me, that's as big a problem as the first, if not bigger. And in some respects, it's some of the lowest hanging fruit when it comes to education, because we're not talking about a need to reform the K-12 system or to improve outcomes in the K-12 system, which is part of the challenge, and I'm so impressed by the improvements that are happening here in Washington, D.C. These are students who are perfectly qualified, and the gap that is missing is the gap that gets them from the high school into the college that they could thrive in.
Yeah, no, you may know a lot of my work has been trying to reimagine the College Board as a source of propulsion behind students.
Right.
And it's my own conviction that when the list of things to go to college becomes too long, it hurts low-income students the most. Every step you add, every new seeming requirement slows down most those kids with the most to lose. And so a real demand on our work is to try to think about, don't get lost in a few people complaining about it being anxious, but don't ignore them either. Don't ignore the mental health issues we see
right.
in some parts of our society. The middle class worries, I think, are fairly different about affordability now.
Right.
Is like a vice grip around a whole segment of our society that's not thinking about how to get in, but how the heck to pay.
Right.
And then there's a lower income community that you're right is barely in the race altogether. And how do you at once be a great institution for all these groups and honor all of them?
Right.
And honor, by the way, school counselors and independent school counselors that are often caught in the middle serving all these kinds of families, sometimes suffering great cruelty, by the way,
right.
of families who want things for their children and standing against those families. So I think that's part of the hardest work you all do. My last question for you, I have so many more, but time is our enemy. I just wanted to ask you, you seem like a pretty inspiring guy. You're talking to 2,000 people who might help you. Is there anything you ask of us? As you look out at this audience, can we help you do good? Can we help you be great and good?
Yes, is the answer. I've got a list of about 15 things that are...
We only have about 1 minute, so prioritize, would you, dear? And my team has no more bandwidth for any addition. No, I'm just kidding. They make me say that.
So some of this is driven by personal experience, but some of it is driven by this idea of being great and good and what it means to be a public university. And that is, I am really interested in first-generation students. And I think that one of the most important promises of education, and especially higher education, is social and economic mobility. And there is no group, I think, that can benefit more from that than first-generation students. I mean, I know this will sound corny, but I think when you see first-generation students succeed in college, you are seeing what most people think of as a version of the American dream coming true. And I think that all of us who are working in education, I mean, all students deserve opportunities. Ensuring that first-generation students have the opportunity to go to the very best colleges or universities that they can, I think that is an incredibly worthy goal. We are at the University of Virginia, again, with the leadership of Greg, spending an awful lot of time thinking about how we can become one of the very best universities in the country for first-generation students, because I think that's a way that we fulfill our mission as a public university.
You know, first-generation is a category that shatters categories.
Exactly.
It is at once the Native American community, the rural white community, the rural black community, the Latinos, but so many. It breaks down so many distinctions. And when I think of you, I think at a time of division, there are few people I've ever met who give a hope for integration, for possibly it might draw us together in a mighty cause. Congratulations, we can't wait to see what you do next. Thank you.
Thank you, thanks so much. Thanks. Yeah, I really enjoyed it.
Thank you for attending this afternoon's session, everyone. Please join us for our college fair and reception at 5:45 p.m. on the lower level in Exhibit Hall C. Enjoy your evening.